So it's my great pleasure to be here at Keio again, but this actually is my first time on this Yagami campus, so I'm very glad to be here. So on this occasion of a topical workshop on semiconductor spintronics, I am going to talk to you about recent topics in magnetic semiconductors, diluted magnetic semiconductors. And I belong to three organizations, all at Tohoku University. My collaborators, I would like to thank particularly Fumihiro Matsukura, Shoji Ikeda, Mike Savitsky, and Tomasz Dietl. The two are from Polish Academy of Sciences. And the work has been supported by the first program of the SPS. So maybe I need to define what's recent and what's not recent. So we've been working on ferromagnetism in semiconductors for quite some time. And we believe that it has functioned. Ferromagnetism in semiconductors have functioned as a window on the future of spintronics, through which we can see, you know, what's going to happen in spintronics. So, for example, we did material science of magnetism in semiconductors. I will briefly touch upon this later in my talk. We did electrical manipulation of magnetism. We changed the ferromagnetic phase transition temperature by applying electric field, and by which we control the carrier concentration in ferromagnetic semiconductors. And we also did, this was actually the first experiment on spin injection, solid state spin injection from a ferromagnet using a ferromagnetic semiconductor and non-magnetic semiconductor heterostructures. So based on these, we extended our work recently on a number of fronts. But today I would like to first talk about electric manipulation by electric field, magnetism, and also which includes transition temperature versus Hall concentration. We needed to understand this. Also, we did direct magnetometry of electric field effects on ferromagnetic semiconductors, and similarly on the effect on the anomalous Hall effect, and also electrical manipulation of magnetization vector, which we went beyond ferromagnetic semiconductors and went into metals to see to show what we can do with electric field manipulation. And if I have enough time, I will discuss also about the materials other than those three, five-based ferromagnetic semiconductors that I will be focusing on in the first half of my talk. All right, so basically we alloy manganese and gallium arsenide, or indium arsenide. Indium arsenide, gallium arsenide are known as non-magnetic semiconductors we use for high-speed transistors and lasers. And we make these indium arsenide, gallium arsenide magnetic, and not only magnetic, but ferromagnetic. In this case, particular case, below 100 Kelvin, spontaneous magnetization shows up, and we see that our material is ferromagnetic below 100 Kelvin. And there are magnetic anisotropies, meaning that there are directions, crystal directions, along which it's very difficult to align magnetization, or along which very easy to align magnetization. So there are crystalline anisotropy built into this material, and which plays a role later on in my talk. Okay, this is a model we put forward. Not all agree on this model, but we've been able to explain a very large number of experimental results, or even quantitatively based on rather simple model. The model has two components. One is carrier spin, and the other is manganese spin. We introduce with introduction of manganese, we introduce manganese localized spins. These usually manganese in 3-5s have 5 D spins, particularly in gallium arsenide and indium arsenide. And also manganese acts as an acceptor, and we introduce holes. And holes also have spins. So there are exchange interaction, and when magnetization is non-zero, free energy of manganese spins increases because we brought some order into the system. But because of this exchange interaction, we exchange split carrier bands, which always gives us an extra energy stabilization. And this part of free energy decreases as you lower the energy temperature. So at some temperature, we can balance the two, and that's your transition temperature. And this is actually based on Zener's proposal some years ago, and that's the reason why we call it Zener. And the P is due to the fact that we are dealing with the valence band of gallium arsenide, which is made of P orbital of cation, and D is our manganese D electrons. So this is a calculated result and experimental points, which shows that we can correctly reproduce the chemical trend. This is zinc manganese with holes, zinc manganese terride with holes. These are indium manganese arsenide. This is gallium manganese arsenide and also carrier concentration. This is also a calculation versus this is calculation, assuming these numbers, and these are observed highest Curie temperatures on various materials. And we can see that the chemical trend is reproduced. All right, also going beyond this, I would like to show that our manganese are randomly distributed in gallium manganese arsenide, for example. And this was shown by atom probe microscopy, which you can see the distribution of manganese in gallium arsenide. And we can analyze the distribution of manganese. These are spatially resolved. And we can see that it's randomly distributed within the experimental era. So we can safely assume that even though we are talking about a high concentration, let's say 5-10% manganese in gallium manganese arsenide, and very thin layer, let's say 10 nanometers or so, but we can safely assume that they are randomly distributed and no clustering is happening. So what I would like to show in the following, this is my first topic, is the electric field effect. If you're dealing with metal insulator, metal ordinary capacitor, when you apply a voltage on a capacitor, you accumulate charge and you deplete, well, you accumulate electrons and you deplete electrons. And the screening length is very short. So it's usually you cannot see much effect on metals. But if you're talking about semiconductors like we are doing, and remember that our ferromagnetism is stabilized because of the presence of holes. We can change the number of holes by applying electric field. And in this region, we can change the transition temperature and other magnetic properties. So let's see what we have done. This is indium manganese arsenide, 5 nanometers thin, in order to in order for electric fields to penetrate well into indium manganese arsenide. And this is our insulator and this is our metal. And we apply electric field upon this capacitor structure. And as you can see here, at the temperature slightly below transition temperature, without applying or gate electric field or making this gate electrode potential the same as source, our hysteresis loop measured by the anomalous Hall effect, which is dominated by magnetization perpendicular to the plane, it shows soft hysteresis. And when you apply positive 1.5 megavolt per centimeter, which means we are depleting holes from the system, we can completely eliminate the hysteresis. Reversing the polarity, we have this square hysteresis, meaning that we are now enhancing the ferromagnetic interaction, and we can go back to virtually the same curve as we have as shown in the slide. We've done this very similar thing with gallium manganese arsenide. And this is our gallium manganese arsenide, 7 nanometer. And this is our spontaneous magnetization measured by the Hall effect. And by definition, when at the temperature at which spontaneous magnetization goes to zero is your transition temperature. And so it means that we can change this range of transition temperature by applying plus minus 5 megavolt per centimeter. And this is our theory model, and this is our experimental result. Clearly, the order of magnitude of transition temperature is good, but the slope are very different. Slopes are very different. So we need to understand more about this. So we did this, repeated this previous experiment, and measured the transition temperature as a function of a Hall concentration. And this is what we got from experiment, and this is what we expect from the model I have just described. So it's both experiment and model, transition temperature is proportional to Hall concentration to some exponent, but this exponent is very different, in this case 0.2, in this case 0.6 to 0.8. So these are our samples. This is one sample out of 12 samples we measured with different composition on different thicknesses, and all appear to have exponent of 0.2, and the theory does not predict this 0.2. So in order to solve this, we measured our magnetization or magnetic moments in gallium manganese arsenide directly by squid magnetometer, which was not an easy task, because gallium manganese arsenide in our field effect structure is very thin, in this particular case 3.5 nanometers. And manganese, that is a source of our magnetic moments, is also dilute, 7%. So we had to make our capacitor structure large enough to get a reasonably good signal-to-noise ratio. But making a large capacitor is actually technologically very difficult, because one weak spot gives you a short circuit, and the entire capacitor doesn't function as a capacitor. So it took quite some time for us to get this capacitor structure, but eventually we succeeded in making it. And this is one example. This is our magnetic moments per area versus temperature. And by varying the voltage we apply to the gate, we can change the transition temperature by this amount. I will not go into the details of complex temperature dependence, which is due to the temperature dependence of magnetic anisotropy. But I would like to point out here that if you assume that all the gallium manganese arsenide layer, 3.5 nanometer, is participating in ferromagnetism, at the lowest temperature we should expect that our magnetic moment is always the same, because after all the manganese included within gallium manganese arsenide is spin polarized, and we should have the same magnetic moments. But this is clearly not the case here. And it means that by applying electric field, we are depleting carriers, by this depletion, the manganese that participate in ferromagnetism, the number of manganese reduces. So this is our model. This is our 3.5 nanometer gallium manganese arsenide. And by applying electric field, we change the carrier concentration from the interface of gallium manganese arsenide and insulator. And by depleting carriers, we lose ferromagnetism, and these manganese do not show up in ferromagnetic part of magnetization. And this way, we can explain rather nicely, assuming reasonable numbers, we can reproduce the gate voltage dependence of the zero temperature magnetization, this part. And you cannot even tell which one is calculation, which one is experiment. So clearly, this is what's happening. And in addition, we took into account the fact that we do not have uniform distribution of carriers in our system, and modified our transition temperature expression. And taking into the fact this non-uniform distribution, we also could reproduce the transition temperature as a function of gate voltage. And this actually reproduces this exponent of 0.2 that we see in our experiment. So the reason why we didn't see this originally we expected this exponent to be around 0.8, 0.6, but the reason why we didn't see it is because we have this non-uniform carrier distribution in our system. In order to prove further that this is the case, so the next question we addressed very briefly here is, why is this exponent always 0.2? And this is an exponent, gamma, as a function of a potential or Fermi level position at the interface between gallium manganese arsenide and interface, insulator, sorry. And it has a rather weak dependence on where it is pinned at the interface, but this 0.5, which is known in gallium arsenide at least, that our Fermi level is usually pinned at half an electron volt away into the band gap from the valence band. And indeed, if you see this 0.5, it gives us 0.2, exponent 0.2. So we can, our conclusion here is that Fermi level is playing a role, and that's the reason why we always get this 0.2 exponent. Another way of proving it, we went to gallium manganese antimonide rather than gallium manganese arsenide. I have shown you this, that the exponent is around 0.2. Gallium manganese antimonide is known to pin its surface Fermi level within the valence band. So we naturally expect that our exponent should be much greater than 0.2 that we see in gallium manganese arsenide. And indeed, in this particular case, we have observed an exponent of 0.78, consistent with our interpretation or explanation of our results. So 0.2 is not a universal number or exponent, but it is due to the fact that we have Fermi level pinning in our system. Okay, so another interesting thing that we can address with electric field effect is this anomalous Hall effect. No theory exists for what we have seen here, but nevertheless, I would just like to show you the results for fun. This is a usual temperature dependence of anomalous Hall effect. This anomalous Hall resistance, which is dominated by this part, and also this is our resistance of our sample sheet resistance. And as you can see, when you deplete carriers, the resistance goes up, and when you accumulate carriers, resistance goes down. And there is some signature of ferromagnetic transition appearing on the temperature dependence of resistance of our sample. So this is what we usually see. But when you make your gallium manganese arsenide in such a way that your conductance of gallium manganese arsenide is high, and also making this gallium arsenide thin, you start to see a funny effect like this one. So now our anomalous Hall effect collapses, and it even changed sign here. This is at low temperature 10 Kelvin, which is around here, and it even changes its sign, but we do not see any anomaly in resistance curve. We do not see any anomaly in magnetization curve. So there's something going on, which we do not actually know, but we do not have any theory that can explain this. Another thing here is that here we apply negative electric field, and our sign goes from negative to positive. But here we apply negative electric field, and our sign goes from positive to negative. So there are two variations. It's tempting to interpret this behavior by assuming that we are seeing some intrinsic anomalous Hall effect contribution, which depends on the curvature of the valence band that we are probing. And remember that we're dealing with very thin gallium arsenide, and our conductance is rather high, so our coherence length is long. So we imagine that we see some band folding and band crossing, and that can change the curvature from positive to negative, negative to positive. So depending on which part we are probing with the electric field, we can have this this plus to minus, or we can get minus to plus anomalous Hall sign polarity. But this is just one way of explaining it. But it's nice to be able to change the carrier concentration and probe what's going on. By this way, we hope that we have given theorists enough data so that they can build some theory to explain what we are seeing here. Okay, the next topic is magnetic anisotropy. This is gallium arsenide valence band with exchange interaction. So we assume that we have a perfect gallium arsenide with manganese in it, which only acts upon valence band through its magnetization and exchange interaction. It splits into four bands, and the reason for this is that each band has different spin orbit interaction contribution. And spin orbit interaction is a source of magnetic anisotropy. So what we can expect, or what we can imagine from this, is that by changing carrier concentration, we can change the emphasis on which band is dominating the spin orbit interaction or magnetic anisotropy. By the way, magnetic anisotropy is basically the energy is different with different magnetization directions. So easy direction is the lowest energy direction. Hardest direction is gives you the hardest, highest energy, magnetic anisotropy energy. So what we imagine here is that we might be able to see the change of magnetization direction by just changing carrier concentration of our gallium manganese arsenide. And this is what we had in mind. And indeed, we measured magnetization direction. I will not go into the details of what we done here. But basically, our magnetization in this case are lying in the plane, and we measured a voltage across this layer by flowing current through it. And depending on which direction this magnetization is pointing to, we get a Hall voltage-like voltage, which is called planar Hall effect, but it is nothing to do with the ordinary Hall effect, because we do not have magnetization or magnetic field pointing perpendicular to it. And if nothing happens, this is proportional to the direction of magnetic field, which we apply within in the plane of this device. But if you have magnetic anisotropy, it also acts participate in determining the direction of magnetization. So we can, from which we can determine magnetic anisotropy as a function of carrier concentration. So this is what we did here. We applied a magnetic field within the plane, and we rotated about the perpendicular axis. If there is no magnetic anisotropy, we should see a cosine function here. But as you can see, with this 0.15 Tesla applying and rotating magnetic field within the plane, we see that our curve is not cosine, but deviated from cosine. And we can, from which we can determine that, this is your easy axis, because even though we're changing the magnetic field direction, the direction of magnetization doesn't change. So clearly, it means that magnetic anisotropy is producing some energy minimum here, and we are having difficult time deflecting magnetization direction from its original position, and that's the reason why we are seeing plateau here. So by analyzing this, we can get two fields that is related to anisotropy, which is this is biaxial anisotropy and this is uniaxial anisotropy. And by measuring these curves and doing this using this function for free energy, we can determine this biaxial anisotropy field and uniaxial anisotropy field. And clearly, we are changing by changing electric field or changing carrier concentration, we can change the uniaxial part of anisotropy. And the result is, by changing carrier concentration or by applying electric field, we can change the direction of magnetization. Not very large. This was our first experiment done on 2008. Not very large, but about 10 degrees. So we can manipulate the direction of magnetization by applying electric field, which actually opens up a new way of changing magnetization direction. For example, if we can change magnetic easy axis from in-plane to perpendicular or perpendicular to in-plane by gating the structure, we should be able to change or switch the magnetization direction by electric field alone. So let me explain how you can do it. So this is our energy minimum. So your magnetic anisotropy is such that when magnetization is pointing, well, let's assume that we have a plane here, pointing perpendicular to the plane is your energy minimum. And let's assume that by pulsing our device, I can change energy minimum direction from perpendicular to in-plane. So when we apply electric field like this, we change energy minimum in in-plane direction. So now magnetization is not pointing to the energy minimum direction. So we have this. So what sort of dynamics we can expect in this situation? That is governed by this Landau-Lipschitz-Gilbert equation and the magnetization processes. And because of damping, it gradually points to energy minimum direction. So what you can do is the magnetization is precessing because we have changed the energy minimum direction. So let's put it back at the point when magnetization is pointing downwards, like this. And let's make energy minimum direction perpendicular to the plane. Remember that pointing this way and this way, up or down, it doesn't matter, it gives you the same energy. So when we stop applying electric field, your magnetization is now pointing down, which is your stable energy direction. And this way you can change the direction of magnetization by applying electric field. And we wanted to do this with gallium manganese arsenide because gallium manganese arsenide, we can control the by carrier concentration, we can change easy axis in plane and out of plane. But actually, we succeeded in doing it in metallic structure first. So let me just describe to you the metallic structure. This is a cobalt ion, well, with some boron, and this is our target material. And this is our MgO, our insulator, and plus zirconium dioxide, and this is our metal. So this is metal, insulator, metal. I told you before that in metal, the screening length is so short because of high carrier concentration, we cannot see much effect by applying electric field to metal. But contrary to this conventional wisdom, where we measured the magnetization curve on two different samples, actually, with different thicknesses, 1.33 and 1.16, we see that in this case, easy axis is in plane, and we cannot see hysteresis here. And this is out of plane, we can see hysteresis in our measurement, whole voltage measurement. We can not only change the magnetic easy axis direction, well, in this case by changing thickness, but also the gate voltage has some measurable effect on our magnetic anisotropy. The reason for this is that magnetic anisotropy has two components. One is due to the fact that we have magnetization, static magnetization, so which comes from shape anisotropy. Remember that you have when you have a bar magnet, you always have poles on two ends. You never see bar magnet with N pole here and S pole here, and that's the reason why magnetostatically, it's energetically lower when you magnetize your bar magnet in pole at the two ends, right? So similarly, this same film, this magnetostatic energy wants to pull your magnetization in plane. And the reason why we see perpendicular anisotropy in this case is because of MgO cobalt ion interface. So I will not go into the details here, but because of this interface and interface bonding, it is producing magnetization or magnetic anisotropy perpendicular to the plane. So interface bonding, meaning that oxygen and iron bonding produces this anisotropy, and we can change this anisotropy by applying electric field. So there's no screening length involved because we are talking about the interface Fermi-level position or interface population of electrons, and we can change it by applying electric field. And that's the reason why we see these. And using this fact, we've been able to show that under static magnetic field with 21 degree angle, so basically this is our target, a piece of ferromagnetic metal with insulator and other things in order to apply electric field and measure, in order to be able to measure the magnetization direction. But and by angled a static magnetic field, which we needed to define the precession direction, we can, by applying electric field pulse of, let's say, 1.8 nanosecond, we can change magnetization direction from up to down or down to up. And because it's precessional, by making your magnet pulse twice as long, you end up in the same direction. And by, again, so this is basically your pi pulse. Another half pi will produce magnetization in opposite direction. So the incoherent part is something that we need to understand, but we basically we were able to show that by electric field alone, under constant magnetic field, we can change magnetization direction. This experiment was done at room temperature, so it's technologically actually very important. Okay, so my last topic, I would like to switch gear from electric field effect to materials that that we've been working on, other than 3.5s. So this is what Thomas Dietl and myself and colleagues put forward in year 2000, that this is something that we expect if Zener model is applicable to all 3.5s and 2.6s, we should expect this transition temperature. So we are assuming here that when we have 5%, let's say, manganese in our system, and in this P case, we assume that we can have 3.5 × 10^20 cubic centimeter per cubic centimeter whole concentration, or in any case, we have 1 × 10^19 per cubic centimeter carriers. Then what we expect, and we do see, that our gallium manganese arsenide is, our transition temperature is somewhere around 100 Kelvin, which is good, which is experimentally seen. Our gallium antimonide, indium arsenide, we also see these chemical trends, and the magnitudes are about the same here. When you go to, let's say, zinc oxide, if these conditions are fulfilled, and if Zener model is applicable, we would expect zinc oxide to have a transition temperature higher than room temperature, which is shown here. And N-type, it's always much below what we see in P-type material, not only because of the carrier concentration, but because of the exchange interaction within the valence band and within the conduction band. So for example, this is zinc oxide with manganese, and this is 1.4 × 10^20 3% manganese, published some time ago, and work done by Thomas Dietl's group. They went to rather low temperature, below the lowest they have shown here is 50 millikelvin. And this hysteresis is a signature of ferromagnetism, although seeing hysteresis does not always mean that you have ferromagnetism, so you have to be careful here. But you can see hysteresis has started from, let's say, somewhere around 100, 200 millikelvin, or 120 millikelvin, 25, and below. And this here, zinc oxide with N-type, we see that this is 100 millikelvin. So it's in the range of what we expect from this model. So zinc oxide also shows the ferromagnetism, N-type ferromagnetism, at rather millikelvin temperature. So which is good. And what we want to see is the ferromagnetism beyond room temperature in order to use it at room temperature. This actually triggered a rather large number of efforts worldwide to find whether we can do this in the direction proposed by this model. So we So this was an early experiment by Osaka University group published in 2001. They doped cobalt, they produced zinc oxide doped with cobalt. And they have seen a very transition temperature that is close to room temperature. So that's good news. But many groups have produced similar results, and many groups have seen ferromagnetic signatures or signatures that could interpret to be a ferromagnetic signature at near room temperature in various materials, including gallium nitride and zinc oxide doped with transition metals, and even without transition metals. So here, there are many theories. This is by Professor Katayama Yoshida, who will speak today. And this is a model invoked by Michael Coey at Dublin, which is due to this impurity level exchange. This was invoked by a number of groups, including Mike Savitsky and Thomas Dietl. They have seen actually cobalt cluster. So this is cobalt cluster, and naturally, when you have cobalt cluster, you would expect to have some ferromagnetic signature at room temperature, because after all, cobalt is ferromagnetic at room temperature. And it also depends on the shape of your inclusion. If it's needle-like, you have shape anisotropy, and it mimics crystalline anisotropy if it has some orientation, preferred orientation. So it's actually very difficult it turned out that it's very difficult to identify the origin of ferromagnetism in this material system. Particularly in this case, even though in this case it's rather easy to identify that you have cobalt clusters. But let's assume that you have cobalt-rich region in zinc-cobalt oxide. And cobalt is shown to replace a substitute zinc. And if you have this type of cobalt-rich region, then you end up having cobalt oxide cluster, which you cannot identify from the structure measurement alone. You have to go deeper than that, and you have to elementary resolve the transmission electron microscope type pictures. And this also, this is antiferromagnet cobalt oxide, but if the size is smaller, there are free spins at the surface, and you cannot completely compensate the antiferromagnetic cluster spins, and that also produces your ferromagnetic-like signature. So there are many, many, with some experimental evidences that things are may not be intrinsic. Another one that was invoked was super exchange hydrogen mediated in zinc cobalt oxide. So with hydrogen, you have to go to these papers, but having hydrogen, it mediates the ferromagnetic super exchange and produces ferromagnetism in the system through super exchange. So 10 more minutes, including question. So we wanted to see this. We wanted to do our own experiment. And we started from growing zinc oxide on zinc oxide. So basically, it took us almost 10 years to get here. But we started from zinc oxide growth on zinc oxide. Many people use sapphire substrate. But we were wondering it might produce some spurious effect. So in this case, we have grown zinc oxide with cobalt on zinc oxide. So we started from homoepitaxial growth, and then now we added cobalt. Let's say here 10%, 16%, no signature of ferromagnetism. And this is without gallium doping. Now with gallium cobalt exceeding 20%, we started to see some hysteresis. And doping produces some effect on this hysteresis. When we grew zinc cobalt oxide on aluminum oxide sapphire substrate, although the composition is 10%, very similar to these, we started to see ferromagnetic type interaction, signature at least. So only when we grow zinc oxide, zinc cobalt oxide on zinc oxide, we see this non-ferromagnetic type, let's say paramagnetic behavior up to 16%. We wanted to understand this. So we did atom probe tomography. So basically we resolved cobalt distribution within our zinc cobalt oxide. And particularly important here is that we included the interface. Because in many cases, we do not see anything here, but we see clustering happening at the very interface between substrate and epitaxial layer. And in this case, we do not see it at all. And the conclusion here was that distribution of cobalt is, again, random. So we have this random cobalt distribution. We do not have any clustering of cobalt. And this is, I forgot the composition, 20%. So we have seen ferromagnetic signature in zinc oxide, zinc cobalt oxide, 20% grown zinc oxide. And this is a correlation between cobalt and zinc. So when we see zinc, we don't see cobalt. When we see cobalt, we don't see zinc. So there is a correlation suggesting or consistent with our interpretation that cobalt is replacing zinc. But again, here we have number of cobalt atoms and number of hydrogen atoms. It's also have an opposite correlation. So whenever we have cobalt, we always have hydrogen. So it appears, at least from this simple analysis, it's at least consistent with the interpretation of hydrogen mediating this ferromagnetic superexchange. This is after hydrogen treatment of zinc oxide with cobalt doped zinc oxide, and even at room temperature we started seeing some ferromagnetic-like signatures. So as far as these experimental results are concerned, it's consistent with the hydrogen-mediated superexchange suggestion put forward by a number of groups. This is electric field effect, so we do electric field effect, and we made a capacitor structure and applied electric field. I forgot the thickness of the insulator here, but we do not see any electric field effect. So it suggests that these are not related to carrier concentration we have in our cobalt doped zinc oxide, but it appears that our interaction is not related to carrier concentration. Okay, so this is my summary. I've shown you ferromagnetism in semiconductors, and it has served, and we believe it continues to serve as a window through which we see future of spintronics, bridging semiconductor and magnetism. And remember that we started working on electric field effects on magnetism, and now many metal magnet groups dealing with metal magnets are working on electric field effects. Electrical manipulation, here I have shown you electrical, we can switch the direction even, the magnetization direction by applying electric field. And although the model we put forward was very successful on gallium manganese arsenide and indium manganese arsenide, there are examples, and this is one of which, that there are, we can see ferromagnetic interaction without carrier induced, and even at room temperature. So if we can understand these ferromagnetic interaction at room temperature, then we might be able to get a different type of ferromagnetic semiconductor that we can use under this environment. And there are suggestions and partially experimental results that you might be able to get ferromagnetic interaction at room temperature even without magnetic ions. So that opens up an entirely new possibility of building new type of magnets at room temperature. So thank you very much for your attention.